Good evening from BBC London.
There's a day coming when the mountain of God's house will be the mountain. Solid, towering over all mountains. All people will stream towards it. People from all over set out for it. They'll say, come, let us climb God's mountain. Go to the house of the God of Jacob. He'll show us the way he works, so we can live the way we are made. I can remember that first Sunday morning arriving in that little university hall in Oxford Street there in central London, and the opportunity and the responsibility of leading Hillsong Church here, and there's going to be lots of trials and struggles, but thankfully I think I was naive. You know what? I could see a group of people that would be defined by linking their lives with God's house. I could see their lives growing. I could see their lives flourishing. I could see a church that will one day become an attractive presence in this awesome city of London.
Yeah. What can we learn from the innocence of a child? Raising a family in London can be tough, but trusting in God and being planted in the house has given me a sense of vision, purpose, hope, guiding me to live in His wisdom and strength, with no anxieties or fears about the future. Just like a child, she cares for none of it. She knows that her father loves her very much.
I think London is a tough city where it's hard to make true friends. Because everyone seems so caught up in their daily grinds. Even among a crowd, you can feel quite lonely. I mean, a world of one is a lonely world to live in, but being part of church gave me a place to focus on others, not myself. Maybe I'm here for a reason.
London is a city forged on industry, profit, and the bottom line. We chase money, amass wealth, hold on to as much as possible, and hope that we can claim another rung on the ladder, or a pat on the back, or maybe even a gold star. I've seen the good money can do, and I've let God guide my steps and put His kingdom before my own, and understood that He will give to me if He can give through me.
You can lose all hope in a place like this. Shootings on Jamaica Road, stabbings on the high street, people beaten outside McDonald's. But I refuse to fade into the dark. Being in church taught me that I am a light to make the darkness afraid. I am the difference. I am the hope. I am here to change things.
The time is now to lift up your eyes and see. say no. Come on, let's show. Show the world we know. We can say yes when the crowd say no. Come on, let's go. Get with the flow. Can you say yes when the crowd say no? Come on, let's show. Show the world we know.
Turn a blind eye to the need? How can I claim ignorance? How can I fear for self-preservation? How can I not link arms with a brother or sister? There's too much to do. None of the petty, insignificant details matter anymore. Time's almost up. The boat's about to leave. If we don't do something, our generation will have perhaps missed the greatest calling it ever had. It is the church's responsibility to rise up and take its place as the visible image of Christ to our world. Not the red brick building, the stained glass window, the wrought iron cross perched on a steeple. It's the people, men, women, children, citizens of heaven that God has called out. I don't attend church anymore. I am the church.
Glorious church, home to the name. sing salvation song, for the Savior's perfect love. I cleanse my soul in mercy's deep, blessed grace delivers me.
Shepherd and King, I find you. In stillness you are welcome here. Comfort me and teach me, Lord, to know your peace. I look to the cross, Lord, let me see. I find peace, and there I find peace again. Draw me near into your arms, the strength I say
I look to your cross, and there I find peace again. The Lord, my light and my salvation. What does salvation mean? You know, salvation means to be saved. It means to be rescued and to be restored. And the Lord Jesus and salvation pretty much go hand in hand. But to fully comprehend what this salvation is and to understand what Jesus did at the cross on our behalf, we need to go back to the beginning. Back to the beginning where God created. He created all that we see, and He created humanity. But it wasn't just an afterthought. He created humanity with intent. And the intention was that every single one of us lives with a sense of security, lives with identity, lives with authority and blessing. And all of this would have stemmed from His primary intention, which was all of humanity to live in close relationship with Him. But maybe through pride or independence, maybe a desire to be like God, one man chose to disobey God. And the agreement that God and man had was broken. And at that, the state of sin entered the world. That for every single one of us who are now born into this world, we're born into a state of sin. We could say that we're held captive to sin. And the original good nature that man was created with was corrupted. And because of that, the relationship between God and man was disturbed. And man was separated from God. But you see, here's the good news. We were never created to be independent. We were never created to be separated. We were created to be sustained out of our relationship with the source of life Himself. And at that moment of humanity's independence, God, in His love for us, set in motion the rescue plan for humanity. And that rescue plan culminates in the life of Jesus Christ. Walking the earth 2,000 odd years ago, and our faith in Him. Who was Jesus? Well, Jesus is. Jesus is the visible image of an invisible God. Emmanuel, which means God with us. In Jesus, God literally humbled Himself and took on the condition of humanity. Jesus is the physical expression of God's love towards us. And you see, Jesus led a blameless life so that we don't have to. And He was offered as a sacrifice to take upon Himself everything that we deserved because of that independence. And at the cross, at His death, Jesus literally conquered sin. And He set us free from the power of death. He set us free. He set us free from condemnation. He set us free from guilt. He set us free from shame, from insecurity. And then He rose again. And through His life, He restores us to life, to real life, a life more abundant, a life of meaning, a life of purpose, a life of hope, and a life of love and relationship with God the Father. In the beginning, one man said no to God and put us all in the wrong. But at the cross, Jesus said yes and put us all in the right. So what do we have to do? What do we have to do to live in this relationship? What do we have to do to be restored? What do we have to do to be forgiven and be set right before God? Well, absolutely nothing. Because it's by a pure gift from God Himself. See, because it's not defined by what we do or what we don't do, it's by the grace of God. Jesus Christ, God Himself, incarnated in the flesh, and our faith in Him sets us right before God. You see, it's through our belief. The only part that we have to play in this new agreement is faith. Simple, childlike faith. And then through believing, and it actually enables us to enter into the grace of God for every single one of us. Because this is love. Not that we love God, but that He first loved us. And that He loved us so much that even at our worst, He sent Jesus as an atonement. And that through His life, His death, and resurrection, and our simple faith in Him, we are restored to right relationship with God. We are restored to all the original intentions that God had for every single one of us. You see, we aren't doing anything but simply calling out to God and trusting Him to do it all for us. This is grace.
often wonder what would happen if people actually get this. Just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, each part gets its meaning from the body as a whole, not the other way around. The body we're talking about is Christ's body of chosen people. We are many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other. Imagine if we all contributed. Imagine if we all became soul winners. Imagine what the future could hold.